try to say yes, y'all.
Somebody in the house say yeah.
I grab the mic and try to say yes, y'all.
Tick tock, get up, stop.
I grab the mic and try to say yes, y'all.
Somebody in the house say yeah.
You're an engineer, music engineer. And what exactly is the job of a music engineer for the people that are not familiar with it?
I am an audio engineer mixer. Well, my job is basically to it's a technical job. It's to record the artist or track, which is another term for recording track, the programmed instruments, drum machine, electronic or acoustic instruments, bass, guitar, piano. There's lots of miking techniques that are used during the recording part of the of a session. There's also techniques like compression and limiting and EQing, the leveling of each instrument. So when you look at a studio or you see pictures of a studio, my job is to capture the artist to tape. When you see that big, giant mixing board, my job is to sit there and make sure that whatever that artist, whatever band, whatever instrument goes to tape and ultimately gets mixed down to two tracks that people hear on the radio or, you know, on the internet.
Okay. Oh, that's nice. That's dope. How you started working for Death Row?
Well, I actually started working over Death Row after doing a session. I used to work at Track Records, right, here in North Hollywood for a gentleman by the name of Tom Murphy. Mm-hmm. Track Records is also one of the major recording facilities in Hollywood. So I started out working there, and I did a session for Ramsey Lewis's son, Kevin Lewis.
Okay. Yeah.
And he offered me a job. He asked me how much was I making, and that they would pay me a little bit more. And I decided, okay, let me try it. At the time, I was working with Warren G. And I was doing some stuff over there with, like, Iggy Pop and Godheads, some rock guys, because that's what they did. They did a variety of stuff. But ultimately, I got offered the job, and I went and looked into it.
And what's the first song that you did on Death Row?
The very first song. That's kind of crazy. The first song I did, I don't even remember, and the reason being is because it was a session I did at midnight, and the engineer, the assigned engineer to the session didn't show up, and so I ended up, the group's name was Red Rum, the artist's was Heron, Rick James, and this girl, forgot her name, but anyway, so I went in there, and I actually ended up having to produce the track, engineer the whole session. Things was kind of like really hectic. I'm like, is this the way it works? And lo and behold, Tommy D came stepping out of nowhere, and he's like, hey, Lance, just, he didn't know me at the time, but he just kind of like gave me some quick little tips and told me to be all right, just keep going. And but from there, we kind of, me and him, we forged a friendship. But I'll say the first real song that I did was with Danny Boy. and DJ Quick. DJ Quick, at this point, I don't quite remember the first song because I did a whole lot of shit.
You mentioned the One Nation album. You worked on that album as well?
Yes, I did.
How much was this album finished? Because a lot of people say it was nearly finished. Some people say it was just one or two sessions of the album.
No, that record, I think that record was about 50% done. When I say 50% done, I mean the guy had at least, you know, he had at least 15 songs on that, you know, to make up the whole record. He had at least 15 songs. Now, did we ever get to mix it? No, we did. We never even got to mix it.
And what is true about the rumor that Tupac was not happy with the songs on the One Nation album?
I don't know for sure. I don't know whether he was happy or he wasn't happy. I do know during the time when we were tracking the songs and doing the session, he seemed pretty happy.
you know what I'm saying? They say he was not happy, that was the reason that he started working on the Machiavelli album.
I don't know about all that.
Because, to be honest, I love Tupac and I love Nelly's all his tracks, but the tracks from the One Nation sounds really outdated and really simple.
Yeah.
Really simple.
When you look at it also, you're listening to material that was just tracked. None of it was even meant to be released. It wasn't mixed. A lot of stuff, if you heard, put it this way, I'm going to use this as an example. If you heard Machiavelli before it was mixed, you'd be like, this is garbage. The only thing worth saying on the tracks is Tupac's vocals. That's how bad I'm trying to tell you a lot of this stuff is. So what you're hearing as far as the One Nation record goes, yeah, it probably does sound crappy because it was something that was just tracked with the intentions of being mixed later on. It wasn't intended to be out. It wasn't, you know, that was not the intention. We hadn't gotten around to that, along with a lot of other songs. You know what I mean? I've heard songs, I go like, man, why did they do this? Who the hell is releasing these songs? These songs ain't even ready to, you know, and the only way they could do that is this way. Okay, now, we would mix. We would track a song, right? Mm-hmm. And at the end of the session, let's say we did four songs. What we would do is now record them to ADAT. Back then, we didn't have full CD capability. We were still using like ADATs and ADATs and cassette tapes. So you would record to a cassette tape at the same time while you're recording the session to put in the vault, digitally recording the session to put it in the vault along with your master reel, because we had boxes of ADATs and boxes of and the original master tape. So, you know, tomorrow when we come play a DAT of the songs we did yesterday. So we, push play on the DAT and we have an idea of what we did yesterday and what we can use as reference to move forward. So you listen to a lot of references, not necessarily a finished joint, a finished tune. You know what I'm saying?
Really kind of first takes and really first
stage. First stage, because you know what? A lot of the songs, if you listen to them, ain't no Ricky Rouse on them. You're probably hearing a real sample, you know.
Yeah.
Probably, you know, not a bass line. You know, it doesn't have those G-funk qualities. You know what I'm saying? And when we got to the mixing stage, that's when it was like, okay, man, you know what? That's a sample. Let's get it out of there. And we start doing different things. We start doing what's called the additional production. We don't have the guy who did all the sampling and the kicks and the snares, you don't have him around to be in the back of your head. Now we can actually put some musicianship into the
the work to make it really sound good.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So a lot of times that's what it is, man. It's not that he was mad or the quality. Yeah, the quality sucked.
DJ Premier said on Twitter that he did a song with Tupac for the One Nation album. Can you remember something like that?
I remember Premier doing songs not only for Tupac, but he did a couple of songs for Rage also, and that's how he ended up doing the stuff for Tupac, because Rage brought him out to do some songs on her record. I don't remember the exact title of the song. That I'll be honest, I don't remember the exact title of the song, but I do remember the timeline, because again, yes, he did that song for Tupac, but he was actually there to do work for Lady of Rage. Yeah,
amazing. Okay, these were nearly all my questions. My last question is: did you work also on the track "Grab the Mic" or "Staring to My Rear View" Part 2?
Staring, I know "Staring to My Rear View," but I don't know of "Grab the Mic."
I play it. You 1 sec. Maybe you can remember it.
Nobody thought I'd make it. The world called me loser, just a high school dropout. Young drug abuser, mama told me there'd be case like this. I never listened, spent my childhood years in my neighborhood prison. The world don't give a fuck about the kids. I can see from the poverty and the evil shit they did. Send my young nation participation, more hesitation can turn me.
Do you remember that song?
You know what? I'll be honest with you, that one right there, I remember the lyrics, but I don't remember, you know, I remember the song. I remember the song, but the track in the background, I was sitting here going like, wow, man.
And then do you know that, or the Staring to My Rearview version we know, or this version is recorded first?
That version was recorded first, and Staring to My Rear View, the one for the movie, that's almost like a remix.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, so
it's
there
kind
you have
of
it.
Remake of the original song.
Yeah, yeah. Actually the track, because that first track was kind of like... It's kind of crazy. I'm not going to say it. It's just kind of crazy.
Oh, man. I really want to thank you for this really dope conversation with you.
Okay. That's what's up.
That's amazing. Have a nice weekend.
You too.
Okay. Voila. Thanks a lot, man.